a majority of each of the two groups of members who are present, I declare the motion passed.
根据立法会
Motion under the Legislative Council, Powers and Privileges Ordinance. Members who wish to speak, please press the request to speak button. I call upon Honorable Tanya Chan to speak and move the motion. Thank you, Mr. President. Of course, I speak to appeal to members, in particular the pro-establishment camp members, to support my motion so as to set up a select committee to carry out an investigation. Yesterday, the Seeing Council made a decision so that the Commission of Inquiry, under the leadership of the retired judge, Mr. Michael Hartman, will have its terms of reference expanded. I think they have learned from the inadequacy last time. I think we understand lately that we have discovered the missing of documents, and also in relation to the testing of materials, we are interested in the missing documents, and the RISC forms have also been covered in the expanded terms of reference. It also mentions unauthorized change of drawings and plans. All of them appear in my motion as well. I'm trying my best to convince members to support me. This is because the last time that we resorted to this imperial sort, so to speak, in 2012, we'd like to have another go as well. Well, I think even if a sort is really sharp, it will become rusty, so we need to use it from time to time. Otherwise, it becomes rusty easily. Well, since the so-called West Kowloon Gate, we haven't had this again. So, in fact, for 29 times, we have tried to invoke the Powers and Privileges Ordinance. So if we leave it idle, it may become a rusty sort and it will be useless. Yes, indeed, we have already got a commission of inquiry looking into the matter. I have before me the two pieces of relevant legislation, but then they are different. According to the COI ordinance, the Seeing Council make the decision. But for us, under the Legal Powers and Privileges Ordinance, Legal members will make the decision. Well, for the COI, they have already expanded their terms of reference. Of course, we can try and we can be avoid overlapping. So I will try to cover the points listed in my motion. It is not just a matter about safety concerns. I'm also concerned about the use of public money. So, members, please take a look of our previous history. Say, for example, reports of select committees or reports of commissions of inquiry. I think for COIs, usually, they are quite polite, and then it's a matter of collective responsibility. Say, for example, at paragraph 486, the SOI on lead found in water, the blame was put on the collective team. While earlier on, there was the select committee on public housing. It's about short piling. I think it was a sensational topic. In chapter 7 of that report, mention was made about Tin Chung Court. For the findings, a number of parties were blamed. Say, for example, the HA was passive and irresponsible in its management, and then the method or approach was most inappropriate. And then for the contractors of the or the subcontractor consultant, it was said that the performance was surprising. And some of the criticism was quite harsh. Say, for example, lack of sufficient awareness. Or now we have Mr. Shek here. He is the chairman of the PAC. The PAC is also a form of a select committee. And in fact, we always have a table to show the findings, the criticisms, as well as the recommendations. In a moment, I will slowly go over some of the points that can be covered if we are able to pass the motion to invoke the powers under the Powers and Privileges Ordinance. In fact, we are trying to help the Secretary. Sometimes you may think that we always ask you when to step down, etc. Well, others have already been kicked out, like Foucault Wong. I'm going to read out some of the letters written by him. Now, of course, it all started with media exposure. Well, I think the matter before us is rather serious. Well, the MTRCL talked about PIMS, P-I-M-S, saying that it was the most excellent approach or the best model. If you're interested, please read the report dated the 15th of June 2018. That paper started with compliance with international requirements, ISO 9001. Or 90,001, saying that the system has been in place for two decades. Well, when they were working on their own, everything was fine. Whenever they had an entrusted agreement from the government, then everything went wrong. Now we have their hold points, we have their RISC forms, all such requirements. Well, all such elements are mentioned in that paper. However, to our surprise, the MTRCL has been blowing its own trumpet, saying that its systems were good, but then in fact they were telling lies. For this report, I think it has become a laughing stock. It is as if that the MTRCL on a continuous basis went to the construction site together with the Leighton people, as if they were partnering in their patrols. Madam Deputy, please go to paragraph 5.3.1. I think they talked about joint inspection by Leighton and MTRCL.
MTRCL, then joint final inspection. I really have to read it. It's good, joint not enough, final not enough, then you joint final.
As if joint inspection isn't enough and they have to have the joint final inspection. It is as if that it was impeccable. But how come that the forms were not signed? And earlier on, they tried to explain away the matter. We said that there was leakage, and then they said that it was a matter of humidity. And then the drawings, plans have been amended without telling us. We tried to ask them to consolidate the works, and then it could not be done, and then they just cut short the bars. Now, for the corpus, 2,000 are still missing. Now, after this report, I think the Bureau tried to look at the figures as well as the plans and drawings. It was found that they did not tally. It seems that the drawings have been amended significantly. It seems that they are not able to sort of make the figures tally again. Now, we would like to set up a select committee. I think it's worth our while. Even though there is a COI, I think there are three areas that are important and we need to focus on, and they would be outside the scope of the COI. Of course, I've been careful in comparing the provisions of the two pieces of relevant legislation. Both the COI and the select committee will be empowered by their respective legislation. Now, the CE has tried to come up with the expanded terms of reference of the COI to avoid the setting up of a select committee under the Electrical Powers and Privileges Ordinance. Now, for the Hong Hum extension, the South Approach Tunnel, as well as the North Approach Tunnel, well, in fact, I'm not confining ourselves to the three only, and there are also other related works. I think we can also move on to the use of public money. Madam Chair, I'm not sure whether you are on the subcommittee on railways. I think the MTRCL plays a very crucial role. According to the entrustment agreement, the MTRCL have a number of functions to discharge. I'm going to visit that topic in a moment. Now, according to the entrustment agreement, and I have a copy with me here, Well, we've been waiting for it for a long time. This is the EA for the Sha Tin Central Link. Now, of course, the MTRCL has charged the government $7.9 billion as the project management fees. Now, the most that we have to pay would be $7.9 billion, and the most that we can claim from the MTRCL is also $7.9 billion. According to paragraph 4.11, unless their deaths, the government may get more than $7.9 billion from the MTRCL. This on its own is most unreasonable. And then between the MTRCL and the contractors, we have the target cost contract. Well, you don't get it from government papers. It's only when you have a look of the expert report or engaged by the COI, then you get this information. After reading this paper, I'm really shocked. Well, Secretary, I have sympathy for you. And for the government has very vague terms concerning the requirements imposed on the MTRCL. According to paragraph 5, there is this requirement about being professional, and then you have to be a very good project manager. You have to discharge all your duties, and we expect you to have the skills, the care, the due care and concern. Nothing is concrete. The wording is most vague and abstract. So they just try to rely on such words.
These shall be carried out with the skill and care reasonably to be expected of a professional and competent project manager. 咁上下咁啊 ，whose roles 啊，即係包括好多唔同嘅責任啦。咁就係咁 general 嘅。
So it is as general as that. And then for point five, again, it seems a lot of duties have been imposed on the MTRCL, but then none of it is being specific or concrete, because the MTRCL says it's okay, it's fine, then you're supposed to trust him, and then everything will be fine. But unfortunately, that won't be the case, and that isn't the case. Madam Deputy, I think you will recall that the MTRCL has already told the government that cost is overrunning and the completion date will be put back. On the 5th of December 2017, Philco Wong signed this paper telling us that instead of $70.8 billion, it will become $87.3 billion. The government has yet to decide on whether to take it up. In other words, an increase to the tune of 23%. What is being checked by the MTRCL, and how does the MTRCL pay the contractors? Well, two parties will sign, and then the government will get a certificate. The government has to make the payment. The RIC forms are missing, and then for the drawings, they are supposed to be backed up by variation forms if they have been amended, but then they haven't been checked. Now, for the $16.5 billion more to be asked, if you ask the consultant to check whether it is justified, it's impossible. You haven't got the papers, you haven't got the documents, you haven't got the drawings. We're supposed to have the lapping of the bars. Now it has been changed into the copper connection. That takes more money, and you need more concrete. You don't know how much more money is needed. Now, it is said that 70% of the increase in cost would be about Song Wong Toi Station, $800 billion. And then for Wan Chai North, you have been accused of late handover of the work site. And also elsewhere, there is a need for extra infrastructural work. Now, for the taxpayers' money, for our money in our public coffers, it is as if we are being freezed, we are being regarded, treated as an ATM. Well, a colleague has said that it is like asking the goddess of mercy to lend you some wealth, and then all you have to repay would be to say to give a Thanksgiving chicken. Well, please pay attention to the building's ordinance. Under the EA, the building authority has already issued an exemption certificate to the MTRCL. Well, the standards required should follow the general standards for all other works. Now, the government is picking up the bill, but then it is a matter of a listed company being the project manager. Would it be right to grant the certificate of exemption? You pay for it, you give them the powers, you give them the exemption certificate, and yet the buck or the ball ends in your court and you have to bear all the responsibility. And in a moment, other members will speak. Thank you. Ms. Tanya Chan, please move your motion. Yes, I move the motion as printed on the agenda. I now propose the question to you that the motion moved by Honourable Tanya Chan be passed.
Secretary for Transport and Housing. Thank you, Madam Deputy. Madam Deputy, the government attaches great importance to the series of incidents arising from Shatin to Central Link contract number 1112. The government has been taking a very serious stance on the matter. Ever since January this year, when the MTRCL indicated that a large number of works records, including risk forms, had been missing, the government had repeatedly urged the MTRCL to explain the reason for the missing of documents and their progress, and so far the MTRCL has not provided any relevant information. We understand the public's concern and anger over the series of blunder of the MTRCL in the management of the Shatin to Central Link project. We are of the view that the MTRCL, as project manager of the SCL project, is responsible for providing skills and supervision of expected of a professional. We are deeply disappointed and we find the performance of the MTRCL regrettable. We fully understand the public's expectation on the government to step up supervision of, on the MTRCL to prevent more blunders happening on the supervision of works by the MTRCL. The SCL project takes the concession approach, and according to the entrustment agreement, the MTRCL should design and build the Shatin to Central Link with a skill and care reasonably expected of a professional, so that the government can adopt the checker approach in verifying and supervising the work of MTRCL in developing the Shatin to Central Link for the effective use of resources, so that there is no duplication of duties between the government and MTRCL on project management. Well, at the Railway Subcommittee on the 1st of February this year, the MTRCL indicated that the relevant documentation was not done properly because they were hurrying the work. We cannot agree. In fact, in 2008, when the government decided to take the check-to-checker approach in supervising the MTRCL, the decision was made by and large because of the track record and the performance of the MTRCL. It instilled confidence in its project management system. And yet, through series of cost overrun and delayed incidents of the XRL, the MTRCL already indicated that it would make improvement on project management. With the series of blunders continues to happen, the government will follow up on the matter and will not let the relevant parties muddle through. We will definitely pursue liability, and this will include the pursuing liability on the use of public money and also criminal liability. The government will also review the future arrangements in relation to the management of railway projects. As of December 2018, the MTRCL altogether approved 98 works contracts in relation to SCL. Regarding the incident of missing documents, it relates to the contract number 1112, Hong Kong Station and stapling sidings of the Shatin to Central Link. Apart from the Hong Kong Station expansion works, the works areas also involve the construction of North Approach Tunnel, South Approach Tunnel of Hong Kong Station, and stable sidings of the Hong Kong Station. And the contract is signed between MTRCL and Leighton Asia Limited. As we reported to members at the press conference on the 30th of January this year, and also at the Railway Subcommittee meeting on the 1st of February, The MTRCL has indicated to the government that apart from the platform expansion project of Hong Kong Station, a large number of documents were missing, and also unauthorized alteration of construction methods happening in the North Approach Tunnel, South Approach Tunnel, and stable sidling works at Hong Kong Station. The Highways Department already requested the MTRCL to provide a detailed record before the end of February this year about the missing record incident. We are awaiting the MTRCL's reply. We understand the community's concern arising from the spate of incidents relating to contract number 1112. On the 10th of July 2018, the Chief Executive in Council already directed that a Commission of Inquiry be appointed under Cap 86, the COI Ordinance, to be chaired by Mr. Justice Hartman, the former CFA judge, so as to conduct investigation about the facts and conditions in relation to the diaphragm wall and the platform slabs construction works and Hong Kong Station Expansion Project, or SCL. The COI would look into the adequacy of the MTRCL's work in terms of project management, supervision, quality assurance, quality control system, risk management, site supervision, control system processes, report to the government, as well as internal communication and communication with stakeholders and other relevant matters. The COI would also review the extent and adequacy of the monitoring and control mechanisms of the government and the implementation thereof. The COI will recommend appropriate measures based on the outcomes of the inquiry to ensure public safety and quality of works. In relation to the problem of missing documents and unauthorized alteration of construction methods at North Approach Tunnel, South Approach Tunnel of Hong Kong Station and stable sidelings, the CE in Council on the 19th of February this year approved the expansion of terms of reference of the COI to include the three areas of construction mentioned for consideration. At the moment, as it is already known, that the construction problems mainly stem from the project management and supervision mechanism of the MTRCL, and adding to that, the MTRCL has also admitted its own inadequacies. We believe that the most suitable arrangement is for the COI to look into the new findings. Apart from the statutory independent inquiry to be conducted by the COI, we've also set out a detailed examination of other parts of the SCL. First of all, the government has already requested the MTRCL to conduct internal audit in relation to the works in other stations, including the completeness of site records and whether the amendments to drawings are in line with the established procedures, and the internal audit work in relation to Tuen Ma Line stations are expected to be completed by the end of March this year. And under the supervision of the expert advisors team of the THB, the Highways Department, together with the M&V consultant, will look into the works in other stations along SCL. The first stage includes a review of Tok Kwa Wan Station, Diamond Hill Station, and all the control and work supervision records related to the quality of works, such as completeness of records, test reports, which have been signed by the supervisory staff, to review the structural safety and to make recommendations. Depending on the progress, and depending on the observation made on Tok Kwa Wan and Diamond Hill Station, we will review the scale of works in relation to the review of other stations. Our target is to provide preliminary audit results within the second quarter of 2019 to consider whether other stations other than Hong Kong Station can be commissioned safely. Because of the irregularities found in the SCL project, including the missing of documents, the MTRCL has indicated that apart from risk forms, missing which have gone missing, there is also another problem, including the use of couplers for connection instead of the lapping of rebars, as well as the records relating to the testing of materials. The matter has been referred by the government to the law enforcement agency for investigation, and they will fully cooperate with the investigation work. The investigation mentioned above already encompasses investigation into project management and the professional conduct and criminal liability. And if we find inadequacies in ourselves in the process of investigation, we will spare no effort in making improvements to salvage public confidence. In addition, upon completion of works, the MTRCL must submit the relevant completion certificate of completion, recorded drawings and test reports of construction materials and certificates to the Buildings Department to ensure that and to prove that all construction works have been carried out according to the plans and design. Madam Deputy, more than anyone, the government would like to clarify the matter and get to the bottom of the matter and resolve the issue relating to SEL. First of all, in relation to this incident, the COI, under the leadership of Mr. Justice Hartman, will conduct an independent, in-depth and comprehensive inquiry. We can expect the COI to carefully examine all evidence relating to the fact, and through inquiring with witnesses under oath, we can dig out the truth. On the other hand, the MTRCL has already admitted its mistakes and is carrying out audit work in relation to the main works and other stations. And the Highways Department, together with the M&V consultant, will carefully and stringently examine other works in other stations of SCL under the supervision of the expert advisors team. The LEAs have already started their own investigation. Not to mention that upon completion of works, the government will stringently examine all information and the completion certificates submitted by the MTRCL in relation to the project. We believe that there is a pragmatic approach to resolve the problem, and there is no need, therefore, to invoke the Electrical Powers and Privileges Ordinance to have a separate inquiry. I so submit, Madam Deputy, I urge members to oppose the motion. Thank you.
Mr. Abraham Shack.
Madam President, I first like to declare my interest on this topic up front. I have been an independent non-executive director of the board of MTR Corporation for over 11 years. In this capacity, I have to apologize for the sad status of affairs of the corporation. I also like to thank the Honorable Tanya CHAN for giving a very quality speech, looking into the details of SCL. But I'm rather disappointed in the Secretary in answers to Tanya's speech, that while that he has indicated that they will put heavy scrutinization onto MTR and looking into how they have carried out their project management, but the Secretary was rather light in criticizing the government role in supervising MTR as their agent. This, I will go in further. At 40, MTR's standing as a pride of Hong Kong is, to put it mildly, being shaken. Yet all the screaming headlines aside, our MTR serve over 2 billion passengers a year with an enviable on-time performance of 99.9%. It has remained one of the busiest, safest, and most reliable rail services in the world. Apart from Hong Kong, the MTR have been entrusted to operate rail system in key metropolises in Beijing, Shenzhen, from south to north in Melbourne to Sweden. In a nutshell, our MTR is a world-class operator of sustainable rail transport services that carry over 12 million passenger journeys worldwide every day. We must not lose sight on this remarkable achievement in lashing out at the company's shortcomings and inadequacies in managing large-scale infrastructural projects. More important, we must not lose confidence in the team of 40,000 dedicated MTR staffers behind this remarkable figures. Obviously, individual members of the MTR management have failed to live up to that public expectations. They were supposed to have learned from from the serious mistakes in the saga of the Guangzhou-Shenzhen-Hong Kong Express Link. Unfortunately, they have not. The pimps that Tanya said was a frustration. The project was plagued with technical problems that led to a $17.5 billion project overrun and a delay of 2 years. The MTRC board was as eager as the general public to find out what has gone wrong. In April 2014, it set up an independent board committee to review the managerial approach of the Express Rail project. Remedial measures were thought to have been put into practice to prevent similar bungles from recurring. 3 weeks later, on top of the MTRC's own initiative, the chief executive of the Hong Kong SAR appointed an independent expert panel to review the project management, monitoring mechanism, and other related matters. In December 2014, Madam President, the panel headed by the Honorable Mr. Justice Michael Hartmann subsequently came up with five sets of recommendations. Repeated attempts to invoke the Electrical Power and Privilege Ordinance to investigate the issue was vetoed time and time again. Instead, in June 2014, after a member's petition was approved, the council jumped onto the bandwagon and set up a select committee. It took the committee 2 years to arrive at and publish six recommendations. The MTRC should have learned its lessons and become more transparent and meticulous in managing key infrastructure works. Despite a major reshuffle at the top echelon of the corporation, serious problems have persisted in the construction of Sha Tin to Central Link. Last July, Justice Hartmann was once again called into action, this time in the form of the Commission of Inquiry, COI, appointed by the Chief Executive under the law to investigate the latest troubles at the sites. The commission is meant to ascertain the facts and circumstances surrounding the alleged irregularities in the steel reinforcement fixing works and safety concern about the diaphragm wall and the platform slab at the Hong Kong station extension. The commission was about to conclude its hearing when new problems about the north approach tunnel, south approach tunnel, and stabling sidings of the extension works of Hong Kong Station were exposed. The chief executive yesterday expanded the commission's terms of reference to cover problems of unauthorized changes and missing construction approval records. The Hartmann Commission have been given six more months until the end of August to complete the job. I do hope Justice Hartmann, and look at the way that how the government have monitored MTR. Unlike Justice Hartmann, independent expert panel in 2014, his current commission operates on a de facto court of law and is empowered to subpoena both witnesses and documents. I'm recounting on all these documents just to emphasize that there are, in fact, continuous and stringent efforts to have no stone unturned. The Honorable Tanya CHAN's motion before us seeks to invoke the Power and Privilege Ordinance to appoint a select committee to inquire, and I quote, the incomplete construction of documentation and construction changes not authorized by the government in relation to the North Approach Tunnel, South Approach Tunnel, and stabling sidings of the extension work of Hong Kong Station under the contract of Yat Yi. Hong Kong Station and stable siding of the SCL and other related matters. This will inevitably overlap with the statutory inquiry of Hartmann Commission. The proposed select committee is bound to call more or less the same list of witnesses and go through the same document. So far, the commission has functioned well. Critical facts and evidence have emerged daily regarding the major accusation against MTRC, its principal contractor, and subcontractors. But how about the government officials? There is no reason to question either its MTR integrity nor its efficiency. In parallel, the police have been collecting timely evidence on the possible criminal offences. It is premature for this council to endorse the motion at this stage, lest the select committee should interfere with or even impede the official proceedings. It does not mean that LegCo should just sit on its hand. The Public Accounts Committee, Madam President, may offer a more appropriate alternative avenue to, for action. The entrustment agreement, as highlighted by Tanya, do have a provision to enlist the help of the PAC and the Director of Audit, and I have requested the Secretary to really explore this opportunity. There are four government members on the MTRC board, Madam President. The Secretary for Transport and Housing, Secretary for Financial Services and Treasury, Permanent Secretary for Development, and Commissioner of Transport. They are there to serve as a link between government and the corporation. They are also the representative and major shareholder of the majority shareholder, the government. Various works regulatory authority relating to MTRC projects all report to them and their department. Question, such as whether there is a dereliction of their part and how government could fortify its oversight on the MTR contracts, are all legitimate. Such questions should be asked and answered. The Director of Audit is the most appropriate source that it should look into the government's responsibility in this whole fiasco. I'm sure it's not the duty of, it's not purely the fault of Chen Fan. It was his predecessors that have decided on all these matters. And to be fair to him, he is just taking up the brunt very courageously for answering our question. As the external auditor of government accounts, the Director of Audit enjoyed wide powers of access to the records of the department, how he can require public officers to explain and furnish such information as he thinks fit to enable him to discharge his auditing duties. He is thus in a perfect position to evaluate whether the officials in charge have delivered. Such an exercise could be part of his next value for money audit. And we can actually do this before the terms end in 2020. In contrast to the proposed LegCo Select Committee, the Director of Audit will not conduct his investigation under the full glare of media. His investigation will be discussed and won't get into the way of the Commission of Inquiry. And then we have the PAC team to look after the report, as in our usual manner, doing very well. The Director of Audit's finding will eventually, as I said, be heard in the Public Accounts Committee, and those are all open hearings. I happen to chair the PAC together with my deputy chairman and member here, Kenneth and Tanya. I understand that some members are keen to explore this avenue. Madam President, presumably those professionals and authorized persons who fail to discharge their regulatory responsibility will, at the end of the day, be held accountable, be they government official, be they MTR officers, or whoever they are. They should be treated equally and fairly, but not just like the Secretary said, it's all the fault of MTR. No, it's the fault of everybody. Meanwhile, MTRC's reputation have been blemished, unfortunately, and it's a good corporation. Government officials' diligence and competence have been cast in doubt, unfortunately. Even the public image of engineers and the construction industry in general has been slightly tarnished. A collective effort is needed to resurrect the good name of all concerned, the good name of Hong Kong, the brand name of Hong Kong MTR. An accurate diagnosis is a prerequisite for the right prescription. I am therefore as eager as any colleagues to get to the bottom of this important issue. I should not be speaking had I not been a member of the PAC member that looking for value for money. As a board member, I am supposed to bound by my silence, but I'm only speaking what is related to the truth and nothing to do with confidentiality. For the above reason, I prefer to allow the Commission of Inquiry to run this course disrupted before the councils consider its statutory powers to intervene. Thank you, Madam President.
Hong Jin-yu,
Mr. Roy Kwong. Madam Deputy, I speak in support of Ms. Tanya Chan's motion to invoke the electrical PNP ordinance. This is moved under the ordinance. I can say that we have been trying to invoke the ordinance a number of times throughout the whole saga of the SCL project. Mr. Frank Chan, you're the secretary, but you seem to have your head in the clouds. Well, we have a spate of scandals and you try to cover them up. On the one hand, it is said that the COI's terms of reference has been expanded and we should await the findings of a COI. There is no need to invoke the PNP. But what is happening is that the public has no more confidence in the MTRCL and in you as the secretary. Well, you should not harp the old tune. And in fact, on this occasion, you dare not say that there will be overlapping of resources and duties. You instead just said that we should take our next step after Mr. Justice Hartman's report is out. Well, in fact, should we invoke the electrical PNP ordinance? I think if we do not use the imperial sword, it will go rusty. This is the eighth time we're moving the motion under electrical PNP ordinance to look into this SEL scandal. And time and again, our motions have been vetoed. It is said that we need to wait for the investigation results of different departments and law enforcement agencies and the COI. Well, the electrical has its own role to play. We need to put everything under the sun because the public has a right to know. It's really laughable. Ever since the SEL scandal has been exposed, we understand that 40% of the risk forms have gone missing. This is really a big joke. Well, according to the Secretary's latest response in relation to the incomplete works records relating to the North Approach Tunnel, South Approach Tunnel, and stabling sidings, the percentage of missing records amounted to 57%, 24%, and 37% respectively. Even the government is the victim, not just the public, when the MTRCL has made a series of blunders and has even learned the lesson from the XRL scandal. The government remains the same. It claims that it will play the role as a supervisor. Well, I think that not even the secretary dared to make this conclusion. Because today we're talking about Hong Kong Station, and next week there may be another station involved and then another scandal surrounding MTRCL. Well, some members have asked the secretary to step down, and this is no laughing matter because we no longer have any faith in you, secretary. What we want here is to move the motion under electrical PNP ordinance so that we can set up a select committee and to summon witnesses so that we can put questions to the witnesses. In fact, we're not overlapping with the COI because we need to level with the public. We're using public money in this project. Now we have the impression that the matter is getting out of hand. The MTRCL must be taken to task. What about Leighton and also MTRCL's response? So far, they haven't given you any response. They're not afraid of you, Secretary. In 2016, 2017, well, at the time, the MTRCL said that in relation to RISC forms, they worked it out with Leighton. At that time, there was no mentioning of any document going missing. And the MTR also claimed that they have a documentation system. But what document were they talking about? The documents had gone missing. The spirit of this motion is that we no longer have faith in the MTRCL, and the government is rather helpless in getting to the bottom of the matter, and that's how LegCo comes in. We need to find out the truth, and if some people are at fault, they should be held responsible. Don't just tell us that we should look ahead, and then the senior echelon of the MTRCL, there would be a shuffling of management staff, and then that would be the end of the matter. This is not what we want to see, because the public is really anxious. Well, you may say that the incident has happened quite a long time ago, and then the public is no longer anxious. But this is not true. The total project cost is now $97 billion, with a cost overrun of $16.5 billion. We're talking about public money, and everyone is concerned. Don't just drag on their feet, and then it will go out of the media spotlight. And the pro-establishment camp should also consider supporting this motion to invoke the PNP ordinance. Time and again, we have tried and failed. At least we should resort to some ways to salvage public confidence. It is such an embarrassment. Before the resumption of sovereignty, how many projects went out of budget? Well, in fact, previously, in the 90s, we had the Rose Garden project. The project was $163 billion, and then in the end, it only cost $150 billion or so, a saving of $8.4 billion. At the time, all the records and documents were complete. What happens now is that it is a great embarrassment for the government as well, because they are sitting on the edge of the seat. They don't know tomorrow what scandal will be exposed by the media and what will happen to the MTRCL. Well, the government is trying to abide by the rules and take the initiative to give reports. You have imposed deadlines for the MTR to respond to you, but they are not afraid of you anymore. One important meaning of the motion is this. Well, when we moved the motions for the first and the second time, you may say that, well, we have ongoing investigation, there should not be any disruption, but this is already the eighth motion, and there may be more to come, which is not what I want. But when the scandal continues to evolve, there is no way for the government to cover it up. We're trying to give you a graceful exit so that you can find a way out. When you also understand that we have missing documents and that the coupler connections are not up to standard and there are problems with work supervision, and even the government officials say that they only learned about these matters in the media, you have no way out. Well, Secretary, in fact, previously, when you explained about the PNP motions, you talked about not having to overlap our responsibilities, and you have now taken another stance. But in fact, you should not block the LegCo's motion. We should invoke PNP to look into the matter. We're talking about contract number 1112 relating to North Approach Tunnel, South Approach Tunnel, and stabling sidings of the projects and the incomplete construction documentation. Just show the public that the government is also the victim. The government has also been kept in the dark. Frankly, I don't think the MTRCL has learned any lesson at all. This is such a big lesson. It has become some kind of a monster. Take a look at the cost overrun of XRL. After that, we still have a spate of blunders surrounding the SCL. We cannot get used to this pattern because this is about public money. This is what LegCo is here for. We need to monitor the government. It is so outrageous. This is a major project. Well, in the past, Hong Kong gives everybody a very good impression that we do our work properly and nothing would go wrong. Let's take a look at this project. even if all the claims are paid out and all the works are rectified, confidence has been lost. Well, I remember that it was after 2010 when we started the XRL project that the public began to lose confidence in our major infrastructure works, and there is no return. Well, the government, I wouldn't dare to ask the government to embrace our attempt to invoke the electrical PNP ordinance, but at least you should not block us so that, well, you can salvage yourself with some dignity. Don't so that we know that something is being done, but at the moment we try to invoke the PNP, we try to do something about it, and we're called superfluous. How superfluous are we? Madam Deputy, what we need to do is to salvage public confidence in our government. It's really an irony. I am a member of this council. Well, once we kickstart the procedure to set up the select committee, we can let the public know that we're making a joint effort to do something about it, to defend our public coffers. And I haven't even started criticizing you about wasting our public money and the cost overrun. However, Frank Chan, you oppose the motion. Will you harp the same tune in every time when we move the 9th and the 10th motions in the future? We can't put up with it anymore. I think the public sentiment is really clear. We all know that the SEL is a tofu project. How can you ignore the substandard works? How can you say that it is all right and that the matter should only be left in the hands of the COI? Well, they do their own inquiry, and the electrical has its own procedures. As members of this council, it is our duty to protect public coffers and to monitor the government. Well, we understand the majority rules may not have enough votes. But, Secretary, isn't it an embarrassment when you made your speech? Time and again, you have failed the public. Well, no matter what good deed you do otherwise, social housing, whatever, you cannot make up for your mistake. What about the public money wasted here? The public money could have been used on social welfare. If we had done our job properly in terms of work supervision, would something like this have happened? Before 1997, major infrastructure works were subject to very stringent control and management. And now the Legislative Council is treated as an ATM machine. And when you submit the funding application, we are always criticized as getting in the way. Well, we approve the funding, and yet you make a mess out of it. I haven't even started telling you off. We're just talking about invoking the PNP so that we can summon witnesses for them to explain to the public. And your answer is no? Do you know no shame at all as a government official sitting on the other side here? Well, nowadays, when we talk about the MTR or MTRCL, everybody would pass a criticism. It is not really outrageous. We need to invoke the Powers and Privileges Ordinance to request the MTRCL to come clean and explain the whole mess to us, to let the public know that something is being done. Otherwise, they'll be working behind closed doors. We know nothing about it. We're kept in the dark and we're anxious. Well, there is no way to call a halt to this whole scandal. But the matter is, we still need to remedy the situation, because very soon we'll need to move another motion to invoke the PNP again because of another scandal. I urge members to think about this. We really hate the MTRCL. So it's time for us to stay united and vote in support of this motion to invoke the electrical PNP ordinance. Well, many members here have become an expert because of the scandal. And in fact, it will be easier for us to help the secretary or the government to find a way out. Otherwise, you will continue to be the straw man, and then the MTRCL will continue to go scot-free. I so submit.
Dr. Chen Chong Tai. Thank you, Madam Deputy. As the first legislator who asked for invoking the PNP to investigate into the SCL project, I today would like to say something about my latest thinking. Well, let's come to a ruling right now. There is no need for investigation. Now, before I talk about the different offenses of the different parties, I would like to respond to Mr. Abraham Shack. Now, regrettably, I'm not a member of the Public Accounts Committee. Otherwise, I would be capable of helping you in investigating into the matter. Well, it's not just about negligence of duties and maladministration. Criminal offenses are in being involved, and the evidence is very clear. Now, Mr. Chan asked for a PNP to be invoked. Of course, I support it, but I don't think it goes far enough. Ms. Chan believes that she would like to invoke the PNP to investigate into the stabling sidings, north approach channel, south approach channel, the incomplete construction documentation, and relevant matters. I think it doesn't go far enough. Why? Because if we are to invoke PNP today, the scope must cover the entire SCL. And now up to today, we are still seeing new developments, new scandals of the SCL. Well, this reason is quite unexpected. That's a historical legacy left over from 1997. And as a result, at the Hong Kong station, we are seeing how the government has been negligent on its duty, and the MTRCL has committed criminal offenses. There is one point that I would highlight. For the Hong Kong station of SCL, let's look at the nature. It's a property of the KCRC, and because of its the unique historical background with this light, so it has to be governed under the building's ordinance. So whether it's the main contractor or other parties which have to do the works, they have to lodging applications with the building's ordinance, and that is the quality supervision plan and also the site supervision plan. Well, for other sites, that's not needed. That's only needed for the Hong Kong station because it is a property of KCRC. So you talked about the conclusion first. So based on that, if we investigate into the entire SCL, we will come up with more conclusions. Now, the KCRC has to come up with a proposal for reference by the administration, and then they will have to check the drawings and plans. Now, we are seeing that they are not adhering to the drawings and the plans and the works procedures. Now, for changes in other stations, they don't have any reference to check against. Now, for the Hong Kong station, we still have something on hand that we can, based on which we can debate with them. But for the Hong Kong station, this is a statutory requirement under the building's ordinance. The plans have to be submitted. But for other stations, the specifications may not be the same as the Hong Kong station. So if you are clear about this point, then you will understand why it's more appropriate to examine the entire SCL. But there is no requirement for the other stations, so the relevant information cannot be obtained. So if you are clear about this background, then you will know that why I agree with Mr. Ibrahim Sheikh, saying that the government is obliged to supervise the work it is to blame. While for the two plans, the site supervision plan and also the quality supervision plan, QSP and SSB, there must be records at the building's department. If the main contractors had not submitted these plans, how come that the building's authority, building's department's staff have not followed up? Of course, at the press conference, they said that they have been chasing the documents from them. Now, the non-conformance report was issued last April, and after that, they've been chasing up the plans. But that's all. What's happened afterwards? Now, according to the statutory requirements, then you should be effecting payments based on the works completed, but you haven't provided the documentation or the RISC forms. How come that the payment was effected? So the government is negligent in its duty. There's no room for argument because it has not discharged its statutory responsibilities. So let's not talk about whether there is a fraud or collusion. The government is obliged to do something. It is to blame. Now, so far, no one has been asked to step down. Why? Because there is another party which has to take the greater blame, MTRCL. Why? The MTRCL has been criticized by the government after the incident was exposed, and the MTRCL was misleading the government in the initial stage, and some engineers of the MTRCL have retired early. In the newspaper report in Ming Pao today, there was saying, well, as mentioned by Mr. Roy Kwong, and that is to say the MTRCL has expressed to the government that from 2016 and 2017, the relevant documents have been submitted. But it doesn't mention that there some RISC forms are missing. But, and conversely, well, the assessment on Leighton is that they have got good document control. But when the media exposed the different scandals, then we find that the MTRCL has been inconsistent in its remarks or assessment. In 2016-17, it made an assessment on the company involved in the works, and it said that it was good in its performance. And then in the middle of last year, when the government was asking why there was incomplete documentation, now only after that, there was a suggestion that the MTRC engineer personnel was trying to hide things from the government. I don't know whether there is tacit agreement between the MTRCL and the government. Mr. Rooney, Phil Koh Wong, and Mr. Lee Chi Man, the three persons mainly responsible for the LCA, maybe they should retire early and then they wrap things up. And then that would be the end of the story. Is it the case? So why did I say the MTRCL should take the greater blame? Even the administration admitted that they can tolerate people who are incapable, but they could not accept falsified reports. So that's why the MTRCL should take the blame. Now, why the Hong Kong station of SCL has become the focus? of attention. And that's because Leighton, this contractor. Well, we may have our own views whether Leighton has vanished from the scene, tried to vanish or disappear. Now, but certain facts have been exposed. In 2015, Leighton issued a notice to Fan Sheng and MTRCL saying that their works have been completed smoothly. And in January 2017, when they were asked about, say, the quality issues like cutting of the steel bars, during the investigation of the COI, we only found that the signing was done afterwards, the endorsement was done only afterwards. So in 2017, they were just making the endorsement by handwriting, and they were only supplying the information afterwards. So this point, goes to show what happened in 2017 when the MTRCL was chased by the administration, and the MTRCL in turn chased Leighton for the relevant documents. And then when we came to the investigation of the COI, well, it's only then that we knew that there were falsified reports. And it was only when the investigation, after the investigation started, did they furnish the information or try to sign the documents. So Leighton was producing falsified documents, cheating MTRC and the government. So the conclusion is that, well, the government has been negligent in its statutory duties, and the MTRCL, as the main contractor, it's careless, and their staff might possibly be involved in some organized crimes. Well, your time, well, you've spent already 11 minutes 45 seconds, and this motion is about investigating into the incomplete construction document. Implementation and construction changes not authorized by the government in relation to the NAT and SAT and stabling sidings. Please focus on those issues. The conclusion is that the MTRCL, government officials, and the Leighton should be convicted. I so speak.
Mr. Leung Yu Chong. Madam Deputy, I speak in support of the motion moved by Ms. Tanya CHAN under the Legislative Council Powers and Privileges Ordinance. In other words, we should appoint a select committee to inquire into the incomplete construction documentation and construction changes not authorized by the government in relation to the Hong Kong Station extension works, as well as other related matters. Madam Deputy, again, this is about the SCL. It costs us dozens of billions of dollars, and yet we haven't got any date in relation to its commissioning. We are concerned about its safety, and everything has been done in a black box. There are scandals after scandals. No, I don't think the government has any defense. The government has been poor in its supervision. Time and again, we have found that the supervision is not up to standard, and the public have no confidence in the MTRCL as well as the government. In order to salvage the public confidence in the project, I think we need to resort to the powers and privileges, which is our ultimate imperial sword. Well, I don't think they should wait for the government or they should wait for the legislature to give them a nudge or to give them a push before they will take their task seriously. Well, Madam Deputy, last month, the Highways Department was told that the north approach tunnel, south approach tunnel, as well as the stabling sidings, have also suffered from incomplete documentation, and 40% of the RISC forms are missing. And what is even more surprising is that without authorization from the government, the plans and drawings have been amended. Well, again, we have got the same contractor, that is Leighton Asia. Well, the government called a press conference. Mr. Frank Chen, the Secretary for Transport and Housing, said in with great confidence that the government oversaw the MTRCL, and then the MTRCL may be sort of taken to task in case something wrong has been found. So it seems that the government is playing the victim. The government is the major shareholder of the MTRCL, and yet the government is blaming everything on the corporation. It seems that the government cannot do anything about it in relation to the incomplete documentation. So it seems that the government is true to its notorious image, that is, the government cannot do much in reality despite all the empty words. Now, for the COI on the Hong Kong station, it has its terms of reference expanded. But what about the other stations? I think the other stations of the SCL should also be included. But this call has been rejected, saying that it will take too much time. I don't think this is an argument that is convincing, if simply because it will take us too much time. And then, on the 30th of January, at a press conference, when a reporter asked whether the matter has been reported to the police, the Director of Highways said that at the moment, no criminal element had been discovered, and so no report has been made to the police. And yet, on the 1st of February, Mr. Frank Chan said that the report has already been referred to the police. Later on, the media found that on the 4th of February, it was only on that day that the Highways Department made a report to the police. Now, we have got two very senior public officers, and they don't agree between themselves on a matter as simple as whether a report has been made or not. So it shows that there is poor coordination and lack of communication among government departments. For the MTR, it claims that it will tie in with the government's investigation. And regarding the lack of sufficient documentation from Leighton, MTR said that it was disappointed and it would urge the contractor to make up the shortfall. So it sounds great, but then the MTR is trying to shed responsibility. Leighton failed to submit the records. But it doesn't mean that the MTR has been discharging its supervisory functions. Well, some senior management members of the MTR have even said that despite the poor documentation, it didn't show that there would be problems with the safety issue. So don't you think that they are really rather shameless? In fact, the MTRCL have been sort of self-contradictory. On day one, it was said that for the incomplete documentation, some of the forms have already been countersigned. And then later on, the manager said that, well, it wasn't like that. And he admitted that the MTR had never received the RISC forms from Leighton, and they had never signed on it, and they had never verified it. So if it is not self-contradiction, what is it? And then another director of the MTR told us that when the contractor provided the forms to the MTR, the forms will be uploaded to the website. Since they could not be found on the website, so probably it was merely a question of failure to submit the forms. So it is really confusing and contradictory. It shows, or it reflects very badly on the MTR, how can they convince us that the MTR can really discharge the function of checking the checker and supervising the contractor's performance? Now, the MTR is still trying to say kind words for the latent, saying that probably it is only an isolated case. The MTR has been insisting that it is not a matter of deliberate act on the part of the contractor. Now, the MTR hasn't been informed in advance, and the MTR itself has very poor management. So how can they be so sure that it has not happened in the past? So for them to make such a statement, are they trying to protect the contractor, or are they trying to water down the role they should play? All I can say is that probably things are more complicated than we are made to believe. Probably certain people are trying to hide the truth from us. Now, the MTRCL has become an autonomous empire, and the MTRCL thinks that we can always foot the bill. When there's a cost overrun, they will turn to the taxpayers and they would allow shoddy quality to prevail in their works. Now, we want to carry out an investigation, but what the government has been promising in relation to investigation follow-up, I don't think they're going to be effective. Whenever we have a scandal concerning the SCL, we say that we want to invoke the powers and privileges. Unfortunately, whenever the pro-establishment camp members criticize the MTR, they will be infuriated. And yet, when it comes to the vote, they would not at what they are expected to do. They will always say that there is already a COI, and so there's no need to, for us to set up a select committee. However, we have been convinced that the government's supervision is inadequate, and the MTR has continued to be as arrogant as they have been in the past, and they have become shameless. And who's going to bear the responsibility? I don't think it is a matter of the contractors, the enterprises, the MTRCL. I think the government itself should also be taken to task. We are spending so much money on such a mega project. However, the government is a shareholder of the MTRCL. The government has 75% of the shares. But what have you done? Frank Chan, Mr. Secretary, you are also on the board of the MTRCL. Have you really supervised the performance of the MTR? On this matter, what have you done to make sure that there is a deterrent effect that is to prevent both the MTR as well as Leighton from having such a poor performance? I think without the media's unearthing of the truth, we will all be sort of prevented from learning about the facts. So we want to investigate into the performance of the contractors. We should also look at the performance and role played by the government. Madam Deputy, whenever we are faced with a scandal, the government will come out and blame the MTR. I think the government is simply trying to shirk the responsibility. The government is trying to show that it's got nothing to do with the MTRCL. Now, for such a governing team with such an attitude of not taking up the responsibility, we don't have any trust in it. Now, the MTRCL has become an autonomous empire. I think it is all because it's been spoiled by the government, and the government has condoned its arrogance. So is the government going to look inwards and try to investigate into the communication mechanism as well as the monitoring mechanism? Will any public officers be made to bear the responsibility or even step down as a result? If we don't look at the issue in this way, if we don't eradicate the problems at root, we can not prevent something similar from recurring again. So I really hope that that will be the direction that we are going to adopt. Therefore, when Mr. or Dr. Zhang Chengtai spoke, he said that Tanya Chan's motion would be inadequate. I have said that I would support Ms. Chan, but I also agree with Dr. Zhang in that the motion itself was not adequate. I think it isn't just a matter of looking at the cause as well as the consequences of the contract. I think we should also look at the role played by the government. Has there been any improper performance or improper behavior? I think we are even more interested in the performance of the government, whether the government has been negligent or incompetent. I think the government should be the first subject to be looked into. Had the government been more competent and effective in its supervisory work so that the MTRCL is under pressure to exercise sufficient supervision over its contractors, we won't have to live with this scandal. Now, it seems that the scope of investigation will be very much restricted. However, as Mr. Chan, the Secretary, has said, indeed it is important to restore public confidence. To do that, we have to carry out a thorough investigation of the role played by the government as well as the related public officers as well.
Thank you, Mr.
Mr. Kenneth Lau.
Council Powers and Privileges Ordinance, moved by the Honourable Tanya Chan. Mr. President, I'm rather sick of speaking on this topic because I think this saga of the public works, you know, deficiency of the Central Link has been going on for almost 12 months. And I did remember when I was speaking on the same topic last year, back in, I think, around summertime, I was asking the government, waste no time in trying to fix this little piece or that little piece. I think the whole Hong Kong platform should be demolished and rebuilt. I remember I said this, and it was in the Hansard. And now, I will put this proposal to the government, demolish the whole Central Link and rebuild it again. I'm not joking. How can you assure that after the inspection work, we have the confidence to use the trains on a day-in, day-out basis? The stations, the whole link, will be used by tens of thousands of commuters every day. And if a disaster ever happen, I think the whole government will topple. I mean, there's no use for you to resign at that point. I think you should all face criminal prosecution, each and everyone in the cabinet. Now, turning back to this motion proposed by Honourable Tanya Chan, and it is a very focused one, and it just asks to set up a select committee to inquire into the incomplete construction documentation and construction changes not authorized by the government in relation to North Approach Tunnel, South Approach Tunnel, and stabling sidings of the extension works. So there are two things. One is the incomplete documentation, and secondly is the construction changes. It's very, very focused. I cannot see any reason why we should, you know, oppose to this motion. It's very reasonable. It will be a very focused investigation. Now, of course, I've heard the Secretary saying that, well, they are already a commission of inquiry, they are already expert, you know, committee set up. There are also internal committees set up by the MTRC, and there are maybe multiple chains of, you know, investigation, even criminal investigation by, you know, carrying out by the various, you know, law enforcement agencies. But facing this saga, I think it's unprecedented. The scale of it, the complexity of it, and the cost involved. I never seen such a public work scandal ever happened anywhere in any country for the past decade. Mr. Secretary, if you can quote me an example that the kind of saga which could surpass this central link, you know, saga, I would bow to you. Dare to give me an example of a public works saga which is worse than central link saga? I cannot imagine, I cannot fathom that that would be one ever happen. But of course, criticizing is easy. I think the government is facing a very uphill task of fixing the problem. And, you know, you have to face the public, you have to face the shareholders, you have to face international, you know, business community. Why is Hong Kong running like this? Where is the governance? Why is MTRC doing this kind of shoddy work? Why is our main contractors doing all this kind of shoddy work? How would you, you know, fix this, mend this? I think fundamentally, I think from a more macro perspective, I think at the very first beginning, if you thought about it, you have thought about it carefully, would it not be more appropriate if the whole construction project of such an important public work not be given to MTRC? MTRC is a listed company, is a mass transport operator. Do they have enough people to supervise public work of that scale and complexity? Of course, I mean, they say they can. Of course, they can outsource it to another supervisor who can supervise the work of Lighten as the main contractor. And that comes the problem. If they're going to outsource that, and if they're not going to do that, then there will be gaps, there will be miscommunications, there may be, I am just saying, maybe collusion, because too many parties are involved. And then, secondly, which prompts me to rethink critically about the structure of the government. Of course, I mean, many years ago, as you know, I've already advocating splitting up, not splitting up you physically, but splitting up your bureau into a bureau dealing with transportation and one other bureau dealing with housing and or development. But having read through the history of the Hong Kong government, SAR government, and also the government under the British rule, I also discovered that there is a post in the past called the Secretary for Public Works, and he's a very powerful man, an engineer, a professional, who can supervise all the major public works undertaken cross-department. And I do want to urge the government, after this saga, after you fix it, maybe in a few years' time, maybe you can't fix it, just to reconsider whether such a position, Secretary for Public Works, will need to be reinstated or reintroduced, and then you have to have a major reshuffle of your cabinet portfolio as well. That is the second thing. Thirdly, Mr. Secretary, you are a board member, although you are INED, of the MTRC Corporation. And the government, in total, has four directors on the board of MTRC. And what statutory functions have you discharged so far? The Honorable Abraham Shack just made a very emotional speech, apologizing on behalf of MTRC. And I think, as government, and you as a member of the board, I think the government also owes the shareholders, the public, an apology. And I never heard anything uttered from your mouth. But apologizing is just, you know, maybe sometimes just to satisfy some of the very passionate, you know, or reaction of the public. But you have to fix the problem. Now, one of the suggestions made by the Honorable Abraham Shack, because I do believe that in very likely 99.9%, this motion would be voted down again irrationally by the pro-establishment camp. And this is really the run of the storyline, of course. Mr. Shack is the chairman of the Public Accounts Committee, is a member of the board of MTRC. Of course, he may have some conflict in there when suggesting this. But the Public Accounts Committee, do you have an obligation to ask the director of audit to conduct value for money audit into any expenditure incurred by any government department? And of course, the government has in place an entrustment agreement with the MTRC, and the MTRC has a back-to-back construction agreement with the main contractor, and it may have other agreement, back-to-back agreement with other consultants or whosoever. And the flow of payment of money is, of course, from the government to the MTRC. Then MTRC, of course, after checking that proper work has been done, the work in progress been done properly, they will make installment payments to fulfill the obligations inside the consultancy agreement or the construction contract. And of course, the government would need to make periodic payments to MTRC in accordance with the entrustment agreement. And of course, I don't have time yet to look at the terms of the entrustment agreement. But if ever the Public Accounts Committee had a time to do so, I think there will be two areas which I think we would look at. One, why is there such an escalation in costs? What procedures are in place to check the costs incurred by the construction companies? Second, in what circumstances had those installment payments been made for the work in progress? Now, before you make the installment payments by the government, of course, you must have satisfied yourself that, proper work has been done. The work has been done up to a certain standard and in accordance with the design. And where are the certificates saying so? And if you have no documents to rely on, who the hell have signed those authority for payment? And who ever signed those authority for payment should be held liable and responsible. And this is just a very natural analysis of the whole sequence of saga. And of course, Public Accounts Committee is just a committee comprising 7 people, and our power given under the very sacred rules of procedures and house rule are still very limited, because we can only conduct, value for money audit. We cannot dig deep into any criminal activities. We cannot dig deep into other misbehavior. But in so doing, by highlighting where our money has been spent, are they really spent wisely, and why do costs escalated, and how payment was made, we could have thrown some light to assist you in overhaul the system. The whole system of public work, the tendering process, the supervision, the cost control and the quality control, the 4 elements. I've been speaking to the media about this. This is, in fact, the main thing which the financial secretary, Mr. Chan, should do, rather than thinking about day in, day out, how to dish out $2,000, $3,000 equally and effectively to all citizens of Hong Kong. Of course, they deserve the money back. They deserve the money back from MTRC. Why don't MTRC give out a special dividend to all the people of Hong Kong who are using the public transport day in, day out? Now, the whole tendering system, contract awarding, contract supervision, cost control, everything, they need to be overhauled and looked into carefully. This is the job of the financial secretary as well. And of course, Mr. Secretary, you are responsible to him. Thirdly, or the last but not least, I think The construction industry in Hong Kong is, I can't say a monopoly, but not a really, maybe a duopoly. Maybe it's a monopolized market by a few big construction companies. And since we are doing more construction projects, I think we should introduce more reputable companies to tender for different types of construction work in Hong Kong. Any reputable firms with proven track record should be asked to submit a tendering in all public works. And we do not want the same construction company to monopolize the majority of public works in Hong Kong. Mr. President, I am here to support the motion tabled by the Honorable Tanya Chan. And if this motion is defeated, I would also like to support the idea of giving the power to the public. Well, we don't need the power, in fact, but we would like to instruct the Director of Audit to look into this issue. Thank you, Mr. President.
Mr. Xiu Ka-chun, President, I speak in support of Ms. Tanya Chan's motion moved in relation to invoking the PNP, and that is the Council should appoint a select committee to inquire into the incomplete construction documentation and construction changes not authorized by the government on the SEL. There's another scandal of the Hong Kong station of SCL. If I remember correctly, this is the fifth time that we were taking the THB to task over SCL. Mr. Frank Chan, well, it's disappointing the public so much. So there is scandal after scandal. There has been a large number of documents missing, and people are concerned about whether there is a safety issue. Then, apart from Hong Kong, there are scandals related to other stations. Apart from the missing documents, and the QSP is also missing. And the works records are missing. And media also discovered that even if there is documentation, many of the dates are wrong or falsified. Say, including, well, grouting first before a steel is put in. And this is unreasonable work site. So we are dubious about the quality of works, and the commissioning date will be affected substantially. And there's also there's a question of whether there can be remedial works. I am not familiar with works procedures. And I just knew about our ISC and QSP terms recently. These are jargons in the construction industry. There are two major loopholes in the system. First is about criminal liability and payment system. I believe that the council must set up a select committee to follow up. First, the property on Hong Kong Station is a property of KCRC. So this is the only station which is governed by the building's ordinance. So the main contractor, before works, should submit the site supervision plan and also the quality supervision plan, SSP, QSP. So the main contractor has the legal liability and must, based on QSP and SSP, supervises the works on the connections assembly of steel bars and couplers. Now, the main contractor, we found that without the authorization of the building's authority, make alterations to the plans and commence the works. And then we found that the connection differs from that specified in the plans. And there are also missing quality supervision records. So they are not just breaching the contract, they are also breaching the building's ordinance. So it's been 1 year on, but the building's department hasn't been taking legal action after it knew about the situation. So they are
deliberately condoning the act and not acting in accordance with the law. Maybe some people have been perverting the course of justice through administrative means. And on RISC form, this is a tool for safeguarding the work process. Before the next stage of works can start, the RISC form must be submitted to ensure that it's fit to go ahead with the next stage. Now, it is very difficult to start the next stage of works pending the submission of the RISC forms. And the main contractor must report to six tiers, the three tiers of manager of the MDRCL, the MNV consultant employed by the government, quantity surveyor, director of highways, director of buildings, and then secretary for transport and housing, or the secretary for development. So these are the six tiers of gatekeepers or supervision systems. It should be a stringent system, but surprisingly, all these six levels have failed in their duties. Is it because that there has been a high instruction from the higher level that the green light should be given? This is so unbelievable. So I believe that the council must investigate into the matter. And then there is a loophole in relation to the payment system. Professor Yu Chung, Edward Yu has said this. Well, there is a milestone payment method used by MTRCL. It is held in high regard by the sector. Well, we will look at the milestones and to prove that the works have been completed before the quantity surveyor will effect the payment. And well, the documentation plays an important part in this. But then the payment has been effected for the SL Hong Kong station. Additional funding has been obtained from the council as well. And back then, the administration only said that because there were archaeological finds at Toka Wan, and then there were some problems with the exhibition station, hence the delay and the cost overrun, and never mentioned about the missing records and the unauthorized changes in the construction. They are blatantly misleading the councillors. And what is most surprising is the QOS, the quantity surveyor, even though they haven't received the RIC forms and the relevant quality documents, makes a payment to the main contractor. There is no record of QSP in relation to the milestone payment, and there is also the submission of our ISC. So the milestone requirement is not met, so theoretically no payment should be made. Maybe there are some instructions from the higher level asking the quantity surveyor to make the payment. That would not have been done if this is not the case. So this is mind-blocking. Now, some people are deliberately misleading the electrical members, so we must look into this. Now, there have been falsified documentation in relation to the steel bars, and only the forms were submitted after the works, so that the management control, the management of the MTRC has gone out of control. And if we go by the ISO 9000 standard, that should be stringent supervision. The MNV consultant must go to the site to check on the works, and especially when the works are under the requirement of the QSB. So in the monthly meeting, the inspection records should be presented. So it's impossible that the different levels have failed. So I have reason to believe that there is something hidden from us, and they are the different teams are covering each other up. And there is also the change in the connection of the rebars. Normally, they should seek advice from the technical expert, and they should not change it on their own. And the main contractor should also cut the walls after the plans have been approved by the buildings department. They should only commence or work on the works based on the approved building department's plans. So have the relevant personnel submitted an application to the buildings department asking for cutting of the walls? How come that without the approval of the buildings department, the main contractor can change the design on its own? It's very unbelievable. Well, if you think that that's not a problem, then it goes to show that the construction industry in Hong Kong is marred with problems. So I think the council must establish a select committee to follow up on the matter so that we can unveil the truth. And then we should also be looking into who should bear the responsibility. There has been scandal after scandal, and it goes to show that the MTRCL is an independent kingdom. On the internet, there people are saying that even after there is the archive law, well, there's nothing much we can do about MTRCL. You should not think that if we have the archive law, there would not be something so ridiculous happening. Well, the MTRCL is an independent kingdom, and the government can't do anything about it. Even if the archive law is enacted, well, it targets only public organizations. But then MTRCL is a private corporation. So if we go by the LRC's proposed framework, even if the law is enacted, we can't govern the MTRCL. So if that is the case, and if the administration is entrusting the works to the MTRCL, now even if the documentation is missing, the MTRCL doesn't have the responsibility to keep the records. And the government has delegated the responsibility to the MTRCL, and it is shifting all the blame to the MTRCL. And it would not be held accountable by the public then. Now, MTRCL is an independent kingdom. The government cannot sort of have a say over it, even if it is a shareholder. But then who has allowed for MTRCL to become a major monster? Now, during the question and answer session today and in the remarks that he just made, he just keeps on saying that he's disappointed by the MTRCL. But on top of that, what action has it taken against the MTRCL? Earlier this morning, Mr. Frank Chan said that he's obliged to investigate into the matter, make amends and ascertain responsibility. And then when Mr. Frank Chan when was asked whether he would resign, and Mr. Abraham Shek asked whether the audit commission to investigate into the matter, Mr. Frank Chan said that he would reflect upon himself. Well, that is his response. Well, this is from the Book of Li, and that means you should humbly reflect upon your own wrongdoings. Now, the secretary is here, and he hasn't taken any action. This is the ninth time that the LegCo is asking for invoking the PNP to investigate into the SEL. What is there to defend, Mr. Frank Chan? What are you trying to convince the legislators not to go down the route? Is it self-reflection? In the spring reception earlier, I have held two rows of auspicious growths, and we should learn wisdom from the pig, and we should try to exercise justice, we should do more, and so on. Now, it's just past the Lenten Festival, and I hope that Mr. Frank Chan, you should make amends before it is too late. I so speak.
Ms. Claudia Mo. Well, it is said that a fault would be sort of boiled gradually by submerging in warm water. Well, we have heard this for a long time. Well, still, many people in Hong Kong don't actually know what is meant by that. They approach us when we set up our stores in the streets. So this is the same in the case of the SCL scandal. The temperature of the warm water has been increased gradually, and gradually we become used to it. So the rebars were cut. Rebars were supposed to be very strong. How come that they could be cut? So it's a matter of cutting them short. And then subsidence or settlement. I was alarmed when, first of all, I learned about cutting short the rebars. I thought that as long as they fit, it should be fine. And then I invoked my common sense when I heard about settlement or subsidence. Would the platform collapse from time to time? There were such cases in overseas countries. And in fact, we have a recent case in Italy. We have thought that they were good at engineering works, but probably it was quite an old facility and it buckled under the pressure of heavy rain and flooding. So maybe everything is fine now in here. Maybe we don't get anything in the short term, but will an accident happen 3 or 5 years down the road? Nobody can tell. Now, for the people of Hong Kong, we have been sort of kept busy by the Hong Kong government. Now, for the National Anthem Bill, at first I thought we had to set aside everything and try to take it up. Indeed, it remains so, but when we are presented with the proposed amendment to the Fugitive Offenders Ordinance, then the later case is much more serious. So the scandals are getting sort of more and more alarming. At first, we were alarmed by the cutting short of the rebars, and we were angry saying that public money was wasted, and we found that those involved were most irresponsible. Now, as things stand, I think probably that's what the government would like to see happen, that is, we get used to it. You are not surprised anymore.
那种情况出来,关晒.
So you get used to it, you are numbed. The more you hear about such things, you become speechless, you are dumbfounded. In the beginning, when we're told about the incomplete documentation, then people may think that it's not going to cause the collapse of the rail platform. What is important is safety rather than documentation. However, we found that for the documentation concerning the North Approach Tunnel and South Approach Tunnel, etc., it's not a matter of one or two documents missing. It's a matter of 40, as many as, or as much as 40% of the records are missing. You may try to be lenient on that, even if it is about a large number of documents. Maybe the supervising staff have been lax. And since the records haven't been submitted in the beginning, they got used to it, and there is a growing backlog, and so it has grown to 40%. People will think that, well, it isn't a matter of real concern, it can be dismissed. But if you talk to the engineering people, and you should find out what's meant by RISC form. At first, I didn't know what is meant by RISC. I had to find out what is meant by RISC, what it stands for. R stands for Royal? No. R stands for Request.
S, 然后我最出奇就是C,C什么来的? Checks. 你说真的我们要想工程...
In other words, we have to attend a lecture and try to find out what this is all about. In other words, the site supervisor would countersign on the form, giving approval, and then an engineer has to put down his signature. Well, it is only when we have got such a record, will materials be supplied to the contractor? So the materials supplier will be satisfied before sending the materials to the site so as to move on to the following stage. Now, as much as 40% of the papers are missing. We're supposed to have a large number of records, and the media have extensive coverage of the scandal. I think this is most unacceptable. On my part, at first, I thought I could still have a slight hope, thinking that the records will be submitted subsequently. As long as the quality hasn't been compromised, I would find it acceptable. But now, I think, again, I think this may not be the case. Now, Mr. Kenneth Leung is making a suggestion that is perhaps the Hong Kong station should be pulled down and it should be built again afresh. You may think that this is not necessary. However, maybe at the end of the day, this is a serious option that we have to consider. Maybe we have lost all confidence in the public officers. They have come out to say that perhaps there is a case of non-compliance, but it may not be tantamount to being unsafe. Well, I've been talking to people in the MGRCL. They try to lobby us. They try to tell us that the quality or the requirements of the MGRCL works are very stringent. They will always have a very sufficient safety margin instead of giving a full marks of at 80, they will ask for 100. Say, for example, if the line is drawn at 80, they will say that they need it to be 84. To be frank, I'm not familiar with engineering works. And then on a particular day, an engineer told me that it's not right to open up a particular part of the station because that would damage the station. If you want to check whether the connection has been properly carried out, even by opening it up, you're not going to serve any purpose. Now, other than the ultrasound testing, we have also got other tests. The findings are again equally alarming. We have been told that 30-40% of them are not right. I've become very much insensitive to the growing number of reports of non-compliance. We have been told that the copper connection has not been carried out properly. You may say that perhaps some public officers or some engineers haven't discharged the duties. They have been too lax. What worries me is that other than having a lax attitude, I'm worried that perhaps, I don't know what has gone wrong. Maybe it's not someone in the MGRCL, maybe someone in the government. Would it be a matter of an element of corruption is present, or people would like to cut corners, they would like to save the cost? We don't know. If you say that if we don't know, then how are we going to start the investigation? But what worries me is that I'm afraid that it may result in casualties. As Mr. Siu Ka-chun has said, this is the ninth time that we would like to invoke the powers and privileges to look into the problems plaguing the SCL. I'm 100% behind Tanya Chan in relation to her motion to invoke the powers and privileges to look at the incomplete documentation. Don't dismiss it as a small issue, thinking that it is only about paperwork. What is at stake is the trust. What is at stake is public confidence. Well, Frederick Ma used to say that when he said that it's okay, then we should believe in him and it will be fine. Well, it shows that this is not right. I think in the history of our public transport, this must be the worst scandal. It's just like a TV drama. If you have a one-off single, or if you have an isolated incident, like the cutting short of the rebars, then perhaps we can still look at it that way. And if you convince me that subsidence is normal and we are not going to see the station sinking in or collapsing in the next few years, it will still be fine with me. I don't know how we are going to end this saga. How are we going to wrap up this blunder? Now, we are talking about a railway, and yet the construction of this railway has been given such a label and has become a headline in the news. For Tanya Chan's motion, it has a slim chance of getting endorsed. For the royalists, well, they will always be very passionate in criticizing the government. But it is a different story when the matter is put to the vote. It seems that the government is trying to put all the blame on the MGRCL. Well, it takes two to tangle. You can't say that the MTRCL hasn't submitted the records to you and so you don't know. But would it be the case that you haven't asked for the records? So we really have to look into the matter. We have to find out about the extent of the incompleteness of the documentation. We want to find out how come that we have allowed such a gap to exist. Mr. Frank Chan talked about being self-reflective. Well, maybe you want to do some soul-searching. The MGRCL is to be blamed. But what about the government? Can the government dismiss the case by saying that it is regrettable? But then you sit on the board of directors. You represent the government. You are on the board of directors. You're supposed to oversee them. Are you sleeping on the job? You don't know what you have been doing? So this is already the ninth time, and I hope that it will be the last time that we have to invoke the powers and privileges, and I hope we can succeed in setting up a select committee under the Electrical Powers and Privileges Ordinance so that we can hold the people responsible. We shouldn't allow the government to get off, to be let off. Somebody must be held responsible. The meeting is suspended until tomorrow at 9 o'clock.